Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen. Amen.
Dear friends, together let us acknowledge our failure to love the world as Jesus does. God of mercy and forgiveness, we confess that sin still has a hold on us. We have harmed our good creation. We have failed to do justice, love, kindness, Beloved of God, your sins are forgiven and you are made whole. God points the way to new life in Christ, who meets us on the road. Journey now in God's abiding love through the power of the Holy Spirit. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Worthy is Christ, the Lamb who was slain, whose blood set us free to be people of God. Power, riches, wisdom, and strength, and honor, blessing, and glory are His. This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Sing with all the people of God and join in the hymn of all creation, blessing, honor, glory, and might be to God and the Lamb forever. Amen. This is the feast of victory for our God, for the Lamb who was slain has begun His reign. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Let us pray. O God, with all your faithful followers of every age, we praise you, the rock of our life. Be our strong foundation and form us into the body of your Son, that we may gladly minister to all the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen.
The first reading is from Isaiah, the 51st chapter. Listen to me, you that pursue righteousness, you that seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham, your father, and to Sarah, who bore you. For he was but one when I called him, but I blessed him and made him many. For the Lord will comfort Zion. He will comfort all her waste places, and will make her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Listen to me, my people, and give heed to me, my nation, for a teaching will go out from me, and my justice for a light to the peoples. I will bring near my deliverance swiftly. My salvation has gone out, and my arms will rule the peoples. The coastlands wait for me, and for my arm they hope. Lift up your eyes to the heavens and look at the earth beneath. For the heavens will vanish like smoke. The earth will wear out like a garment. But those who live on it will die like gnats. But my salvation will be forever, and my deliverance will never be ended. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from Romans, the 12th chapter. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he said to his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. The Gospel of the Lord. Recent research on Americans shows that we continue to be very interested in spiritual matters. Most of us believe in God. Many of us pray every day. And yet, church membership and church attendance are in decline. SBNR, spiritual but not religious, is a newly prominent category in opinion surveys. We are religious without necessarily being connected to communities of faith. As Lutheran historian Martin Marty has said, Americans are believers, but not joiners. In today's gospel, Jesus talks about church organization. He speaks of what he is going to do to found the church as an institution. But Jesus does this in a rather surprising way. In the passage, Peter reveals himself to be a believer, and indeed quite an impressive believer. Jesus asks, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And the disciples answered, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." But Jesus makes it more pointed, more personal. "But who do you say that I am?" And Peter gets it right, making the most explicit, specific confession of faith in all the Gospels. "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus praises Peter for his belief and then says to Peter, "On this rock," that's a play on words, Peter equals rock. In Greek, it's petros, like petroleum. "On this rock, I will build my church." In other words, Jesus moves Peter very quickly from confession of faith, "You are the Christ," to vocation, "On you I will build my church." Of course, we all believe that Jesus is the cornerstone, the very foundation of the church. But here Jesus says that he will build a church upon Peter rather than upon himself. The Roman Catholic Church has always maintained that this, "You are the rock, and on this rock I'll build my church," is the foundation of the papacy, because Peter was the first bishop of Rome. Evangelical Christians, Protestants, have generally said that "You are the rock" refers not so much to Peter himself, but to Peter's confession of faith. Upon this confession of faith, upon this gospel truth, that's where I'll build my church. Now, either argument can be convincing, but what impresses me is that Jesus turns to Peter, good old infallible, Good old fallible. Boy, I got my tongue twisted this morning. Good old fallible. Good old impetuous Peter, and makes him the rock upon which he will build the church. Notice how quickly Jesus moves Peter from belief to action, from a confession of faith to an assignment of vocation. That's what interests me about today's gospel. In effect, Jesus is saying, you will move from one who makes a statement of faith to one who embodies faith. So Jesus builds his church upon people. And Jesus also quickly moves us from affirmation of faith to enacting our faith. Remember, Jesus never asked at the end of one of his sermons or teachings, do you agree? Or doesn't that make sense to you? Rather, what Jesus says is, follow me. Jesus is more than a philosopher, and Christianity is more than a philosophy of life. Christianity is a way of life. If we confess that Jesus is the Christ, is the very Son of God, is as much of God as we ever hope to see, then we must conform ourselves to Christ. In other words, we must obey Christ as if he were the Christ, the Son of the living God. William Willimon, a teacher of preaching and a United Methodist bishop, tells the story of a friend of his who was born a Christian, but gradually grew away from the Christian faith. This man was a child of the tumultuous 1960s, and he was disappointed with the church's tepid response to the political and social and economic and racial crises of that era. Racial discrimination, an unjust war, poverty in the midst of plenty. Will Willimon's friend became an expert in East-West business relations. And in the 1980s, at a conference on business in the Soviet Union, he had a conversation with an official from the Soviet bloc. You are a Christian, she said. I'm an atheist. Tell me, what difference does your belief in God make in the way you vote, the way you spend your money? What difference does your Christian faith make in the real world? And the man was stunned. He told his friend, the preacher, I realized that although I believed like a believer, I lived like an atheist. It was a profound moment of honest recognition that for him eventually led back to a vibrant Christian faith. So if we believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, then what difference does that make in the way we live? Alas, I fear that all too often we confuse being Christian with being a sensitive, thinking, caring, good person. It's quite a claim to believe that this Jew from Nazareth who lived briefly, died violently, and rose unexpectedly is the Christ, the long-awaited Messiah, the Son of God. And yet, we sometimes call that claim into question by the way we live our lives, saying that we believe Jesus Christ is the Lord, but living as if it really didn't matter. Jesus moves us from affirming faith to lives that embody faith. He forms his church, his answer to what's wrong with the world, upon us, making us the rocks on which he builds a grand edifice that blesses the world in his name. May we be solid rocks rather than sinking stones. Amen. So be it. The church is one foundation, Jesus Christ, her Lord. She is his new creation, our water and the word. From them he came and sought her to be his holy bride. Let us profess our faith with all, together with all God's people in every time and place, as we say the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary,
suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Confident that God receives our joys and concerns, let us offer our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of creation. God of Sarah and Abraham, inspire your church to pursue righteousness in its ministry. Equip us to share your compassion that unites us as one family of faith. Hear us, O God. Remind us that from the beginning of creation, you knit together a world meant for harmony. Protect and restore the wasted places to joy and gladness. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Stir the leaders of nations and towns, militaries and courts, to respond to your teachings. Let your call for justice reach all people and bring deliverance where there is oppression. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Show your steadfast love and faithfulness to those in despair. Increase their strength. Care for all who feel low. Keep safe any in the midst of trouble, and protect vulnerable people from harm. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Encourage those who offer their gifts and talents in service to your church. Energize this congregation's rostered and lay leaders, musicians, teachers, greeters, and administrators, so they may be transformed in sharing your grace. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of all the saints, death is overcome in Christ's resurrection. We rejoice with the faithful departed, especially Amos Kunkel. Sustain us in hope until we come at last to our heavenly home. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray. In the name of the one who reconciled all creation to himself, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
creation. All you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from the earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we might be for the world signs of your gracious presence in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. Our Good Samaritan, who tends the wounds of body and spirit with the oil of consolation and the wine of hope. The Son of Righteousness, who raises us to life on his healing wings. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join in their unending hymn. Holy God, our bread of life, our table and our food, you created a world in which all might be satisfied by your abundance. You dined with Abraham and Sarah, promising them life, and fed your people Israel with manna from heaven. You sent your Son to eat with sinners and to become food for the world. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his life given for us and his rising from the grave, we await his coming again to share with us the everlasting feast. By your Spirit, nurture and sustain us with this meal. Strengthen us to serve all in hunger and want, and by this bread and cup, make of us the body of your Son. Through him, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, both now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The The lamb is the feast is ready. Let us all meet at the Lamb's table.
Take away the skins of the world.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Thankful hearts and voices raise, tell everyone what God has done. Let everyone who seeks the Lord rejoice and bear the name of Christ. Send us with your promises and lead your people forth in joy with shouts of thanksgiving. Alleluia, alleluia.
Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Well, welcome to our Rosemont brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you for coming today. Everyone is invited to attend the coffee hour following worship. It's located downstairs in the fellowship hall. If you go out the doors that you came in the front and go down the steps, that's one way to get there. Elevator goes straight through in the back. That's another way to get there. It's a little confusing in the grid, but you'll figure out which button to push. And this will be a great time for all of us to get to know each other a bit more. Pastor Jack would like everyone to know that he is recuperating nicely at home and thanks all for their prayers and good thoughts. A housekeeping note. Lehigh was contacted this week regarding our lease. The ending date of May 15th, 2024 is the absolute latest we can be in this building. It was also stated that unlike the other buildings, this one needs to be completely cleaned out as if we were selling a home. As a result of this news, it is in our best interest to begin the clean out process. Please contact Nancy Costas if you are interested in volunteering for this task. I believe we'll be starting with the library and the toys and such that are left in the education building. Any other announcements for the good of the community? Oh, Tracy.
I want to use the microphone.
Oh, boy.
What a surprise. Good morning.
So a couple weeks ago, I had shared that I had come across some information via an email about an invitation to the MCC church that's going to be located in the Synod building. Last week we happened to be at the Pride Festival at the Steel Stacks, and wouldn't you know, they had a little booth with lots of postcards. So I've got proof with a picture of the Synod building. I placed some in the back. All I want to leave you with is a question to ask yourself: why wasn't this available to us? Why were we told no? And why would a non-Lutheran community be able to use this facility? Anyway, I just didn't want you thinking I was spreading, rumors. There's proof. Synod building. I have cards in the back if you want to just look at it. Thank you.
And thank you, Tracy. Yeah. Anyone else? Okay, thank you very much. See you at coffee hour.
God, who gives life to all things and frees us from despair, bless you with truth and peace, and may the Holy Trinity, one God, guide you always in faith, hope, and love. Amen.